Come on, all you. Welcome aboard Indiana Sports Beat, coming to you here on this Tuesday. Ready to get at it. Kevin Brockway sitting in with us. Mike DeCorsia joining us. We're here from Chronic Hoosier. Lots to talk about, but nothing bigger, Kevin, than the possibility of the entire NCAA tournament coming to Indiana. Indianapolis, kind of specifically, but that had to be spread out a little bit. But that would sure be fun for us.
How cool would it be to see an NCAA tournament game played at Hinkle Fieldhouse? I mean, that would be pretty neat. And
like a throwback, man. It'd be like living in the 60s or something.
Yeah, exactly. And then, you know, you've got the IUPUI's gym, that kind of Indiana Farmers Coliseum. You've got Bankers Life. You've got Lucas Oil Stadium. I mean, you've got a lot of venues. And
my gosh, you can go to Fort Wayne. You can go to Terre Haute. It's crazy. The places you can go, well, Evansville.
What's kind of interesting is they said Indianapolis metro area, but you know, perhaps, yeah, maybe you expand it.
You could go to Louisville. I mean, you got the Yum Center that is not 2 hours due south, so it's like the Olympics. You know, every time they always have stuff within a big old area for the Olympics, and you can kind of do that on a smaller scale.
You could do Assembly Hall. You could do Mackey Arena. You could do the Joy Center up in South Bend. I mean, there's a lot of possibilities there. A lot of gyms, you know, probably Valparaiso, right?
Wayne's got a big Ford Center there.
Yeah, and Evansville, right? Don't they have a big gym?
The Ford Centers there as well. So there's plenty of places now. And you brought up before we came on yesterday, the Martha the Mop Lady on Twitter put out that really cool deal with the high school venues that you brought up. But you mentioned also that they mentioned on there that the courts are different. It's 84-94 versus high school college.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I don't know if they would make an exception for that, or rules, or could you expand a floor high school court?
Not most of those places.
Yeah. Newcastle. And then I think you'd run into the facilities issue too. Locker rooms, you know, are they up to snuff as far as, you know, what the NCAA is looking for? Do you have weight room facilities there? Do you have things like medical facilities there that you need?
Did you see my post that I tweeted out a possibility too for an auxiliary venue?
What's that?
The Hoosier Gym.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I posted that too. I posted a picture of that. I said, how cool would it be to have, you know, teams in Knightstown?
And my gosh, that was going down. You talk about locker rooms. I've been in that locker room. It's exactly what you see in the movie. It is. That is the locker room.
Yeah.
But yeah, it would be amazing. Yeah. To have that all in Indianapolis, which I fully expect that to happen. I mean, I first of all, I don't see Indianapolis turning that down. The attention, the money, just all of it that goes with it, the prestige, they're not turning that down. And it gives Indiana a place to showcase itself as its claim as Indiana is the king of basketball. Well, no place better to do it right there.
Yeah, and, you know, we'll have to see what the climate is by March, too, you know, where the virus is. You know, if the schedule gets pushed back, maybe it's May, you know. But if you do that, say if the schedule gets pushed back and you do have, you know, some situations, you might find yourself in a position in May, you know, if things are successful with the vaccine, where you could host fans, as opposed to maybe having it in March where you couldn't host fans or host fans in reduced capacity. So I think there are a lot of options there. And I think first and foremost, though, the virus sets the timeline, you know, has in all sports. And, you know, we've got to be really careful because we're heading into a dark winter, and Indiana is in pretty bad shape right now in terms of the number of cases. And not only Indiana, but a lot of states in the Midwest.
Well, just games canceled across the country. I mean, it's just like everything else. The numbers are climbing. The numbers are climbing here as well. This is probably the most games that have been canceled this week. I don't know how many that has been, but I'm trying to pull that up. But quite a few. Let's see. Anyone of note? Who was it I saw? LSU. The LSU game is canceled, I think. Is there? But LSU is almost a joke. Ed Orgeron joked that his entire team had had COVID at the beginning of the season because they had so many and almost immediately. And then now they're having these problems. He's got all kinds of problems. I saw an article. There's all kinds of issues. The NCAA issues that we knew about. There's an investigation going on apparently down there and about all kinds of sexual assaults are not being adjudicated properly that have any involvement with the football program. So Ed Orgeron's got a lot of stuff going on down there.
Man, he's got some troubles.
It's amazing how that, you know, and he still, I think, is somewhat getting a pass on the field, the honeymoon season off that national championship.
It's LSU. Who's their basketball coach?
Losing Burrow. But, you know, as far as the USA Today story that you referenced that I led last night, really serious stuff with regards to this doesn't completely fall on Orgeron too. It's a university wide situation where, you know, you're supposed to report things to Title IX office. They're supposed to investigate, and apparently they did not investigate. They just kind of, you know, put it aside and put it on a shelf and did not really actively investigate these cases. But that's a systemic problem that goes above Ed Orgeron. That's a university issue. That's an athletic
issue. It's LSU, like I just said. Who's their basketball coach?
Yeah.
Look at their basketball. Look at their entire situation. And this is not the first time. It's Louisiana, for gosh sakes. I mean, this goes back for the dawn of time. They've cheated in everything. They cheat in politics. They don't. It's Louisiana. Sorry, boys. Love Cajun food, but y'all some cheating suckers down there and just don't care.
You ever go to Baton Rouge? Mike Anderson's. I mean, that's an unbelievable place. You get the char-grilled oysters there. You're living life. But little strawberry daiquiri or a hurricane in New Orleans or whatever. I love Louisiana. I used to love going there. I went there quite a bit on SEC road trips. But it's pretty tough times there. And the Will Wade situation, as we've probably referenced in the past on the show, is just a disgrace that the athletic administration hasn't done more, hasn't stepped in, have not relieved him of his duties. And they're fighting tooth and nail on this thing, but you know, they're doing the same thing for Sean Miller at Arizona. They're doing the same thing for Bill Self to a lesser extent at Kansas as well. So,
but the thing is, they're not doing it for these coaches. They're doing it for themselves, because if that a bad result comes out of that, it hurts them. So they need as good a result as possible. So that's why they're supporting them, as embarrassing as it has to be, because all those situations are embarrassing. They're all caught, but they'll all get away with it. I mean, Will Wade may be the only guy that does not get away with it, but he's gotten away with it already pretty well.
Well, the other issue is we're in a litigious society, and they're always afraid of lawsuits. They're afraid of wrongful termination lawsuits. That's another issue that's involved here. In reading the Title IX story, they were afraid of countersuits from those accused. They mentioned that as to,
yeah, but that's reason. But see that you can't say you're more concerned with that than you are with litigation from the victims. So there, in that case, LSU is putting the perpetrators ahead of the victims again.
Yeah. No, you got to get justice for the victims first. Excuse me. And you've got to be able to investigate thoroughly. That there's no doubt around that. And then let the chips fall where they may. And in this case, as we've, discussed, or as was portrayed in the USA Today story, that was not done. And that is not acceptable in 2020. I mean, you've got to, or any time, but especially now, where we know a lot more about, these instances, and you have to protect those that are that are victims, and victims have rights. So, hopefully, like I said, justice will prevail eventually, and LSU will be held to account.
On the basketball side, tomorrow, Mason Miller might make a commitment. He might not. He's supposed to try to get a Zoom meeting completed with Indiana and Archie. He did some kind of visit with Creighton, and I think shortly after that announced he's going to Creighton. I don't see this ending well for Indiana unless Archie can turn it around in these last few days. If a commitment if he goes forth with his commitment tomorrow, it's definitely to Creighton. The only way it won't be is if he holds off till Monday, which he said he possibly could do. But personally, I don't see this going Indiana's way. It'll be the second consecutive high-profile recruit. Archie lost in the same position. Archie's in a little bit of a bind. I know that the fans love that he's gotten these Indiana kids, but he's still not getting them all. And he still has not put together a complete roster of what he needs in his fourth season. Meanwhile, Dayton just signed they signed two top 50s 2 weeks ago. They signed another kid yesterday. You got Obi Toppin, who's in the draft from there that Archie did not recruit either. I know people don't think so, but I think there's a problem there. It's on the edge there, Kevin.
Well, you got to build success. I mean, you take a look at what Tom Allen's doing in football, for example, and you have to, I think, get the program to a level where people want to come here. And it's kind of the chicken and the egg argument. And let's face it, they haven't been in a tournament since 2016. They were on the brink of going last year. You could debate whether they were in or out after that Nebraska win, but a postseason didn't happen. But, kids want to go to a place where, they get to the tournament and where they're developed for the NBA as well. That's another issue as well. And listen, Archie's got Romeo Langford in. We'll see what happens with Trace Jackson Davis. But you've got to create that pipeline, and you've got to show as well that you can develop maybe those 3 and 4 stars, that aren't obvious people like Romeo and Trace Jackson Davis and make them NBA players as well.
Like Rob Finnessy was the perfect example of that, who came in with a lot of hype and fanfare, and he's a solid player, but it's kind of stayed pretty flat from his freshman season. Not a lot of difference. He doesn't score more. There's not a lot of change. Not getting on him. I'm just saying, not a lot of increase in productivity there.
Concussion is freshman season. Abdominal injury is sophomore season. He's been banged up. To be fair. But you still have to, show some growth there in terms of, where you could be as opposed to where you are. And this is Big Ten now. This is a dog eat dog conference. And you see, you look at guys like Luke Garza at Iowa. You look at Dosunmu and Kofi Coburn over up at Illinois. This is Nate Rivers and. Micah Potter up in Wisconsin. Got a lot of quality players in this league. And Trace Jackson Davis certainly is among them at Indiana. But, you need to develop and build a little bit more around him. And we'll see what kind of impact Christian Lander makes as a freshman. That to me is going to be fascinating to see how much he plays, how much he's ready. And, he's going to get banged around a little bit as a 17-year-old playing in a very physical conference.
Yeah, I saw that Twitter post a while back about rumors of Galloway possibly starting. I just think that's a horse hockey, but it's just somebody just throwing crap out there that it's baloney. But we'll see. I don't think I buy into that. But with Mike DeCourcy, he's going to join us next. Looking forward to talking to him. He had a nice piece out I saw yesterday talking about all the walk-up music for these college football programs. It was pretty cool. One of them I didn't even know. And then he snuck Liverpool in there. But Mike's going to join us next year on Indiana Sports Beat. Looking forward to it. Stay tuned. We'll be back with more from the Golf Club at Eagle Point Studios right after this.
Hello, everybody. Jim Coyle from Indiana Sports Beat. When I'm not covering the Hoosiers, you can find me at Bubba's 33 in Clarksville, located on the northeast corner of I-65 at Veterans Parkway. Bubba's 33 has hand-tossed pizzas, bold burgers, and ice-cold beer from a select list of local craft brewers. An incredible food selection, all made fresh daily. Whether you're meeting the team for that post-win meal in the family dining area or meeting friends for happy hour to watch the game on one of Bubba's 50 TVs. Bubba's 33 in Clarksville. Pizza, burgers, beer.
We all want a winning smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you will get at Reynolds Family Dentistry in Sellersburg. Reynolds Family Dentistry has been serving the dental needs of Hoosier families for over 30 years. Let Drs. Roger and Jay Reynolds take care of your family. Just off of I-65 at 809 South Indiana Avenue in Sellersburg. Call 812-246-3368. That's Reynolds Family Dentistry, 812-246-3368.
Hey, this is Jim Coyle with Indiana Sports Beat Radio. We're now a part of the Rivals Network. TheHoosier.com is where you'll find complete coverage of the Indiana Hoosiers, as well as coverage of the Big Ten. Simply go to TheHoosier.com and sign up. It's free. You can also catch Indiana Sports Beat Radio there each day at your convenience, or you can find it any place you podcast or on this station each weekday. If we're not on the station where you live, we should be. Ask for Indiana Sports Beat Radio. Now that warm weather has arrived, it's time to hit the links, and there's no better place than the golf club at Eagle Point in Bloomington. Voted best golf course by the readers of the Bloomington Herald Times, the golf club at Eagle Point is under new ownership, has new fairways and bunkers, and it's open to the public. When the round's over, there's cold beer and a full menu at the Eagle Point Pub and Bistro. Call 812-824-1100 to make a tee time. That's 812-824-1100. The golf club at Eagle Point in Bloomington.
No matter where you are in life, here's a question to consider. Do you have the right financial advisor to help you navigate where you want to go? An Ameriprise advisor will take the time to truly understand what's important to you and help you prepare for whatever life brings, both the expected and the unexpected, by providing personalized advice based on your goals and needs, and regular reviews along with digital tools to help you stay on track. With an Ameriprise advisor, you can feel more confident, connected, and in control of your financial life. Call Dennis Schneider, Heath Schneider, or Nick Davis with Schneider & Associates, a private wealth advisory practice of Ameriprise Financial Services. Call 877-827-1404. That's 877-827-1404. See Dennis Schneider at 236 North Elm Street in Henderson and Heath Schneider or Nick Davis at 20 East Campground Road in Evansville. Ameriprise Financial Services, LLC. Member FINRA and SIPC.
Does your bank offer the personal service of a community bank combined with big bank products that you expect? I'm Dane Chandler, Banking Center Manager with Banterra, and with our bank, you get the best of both worlds. Our easy-to-use mobile app includes conveniences like mobile check deposit. We offer competitive CD and money market rates, smart mortgage options, and unmatched business products and services. Switching to Banterra is easy. Stop by our locations to learn more. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
The college and pro football seasons bring friends together, and Leroy's Tavern is a place to watch all the games every week with the NFL Sunday Ticket while enjoying $1 Busch Light drafts every Sunday, Monday, and Thursday. Leroy's Tavern also features a $6 daily lunch special from 10:30 a.m. to 1 p.m. Monday through Friday, featuring a sandwich, fries, or onion rings, or a 7-inch pizza and a non-alcoholic drink for just $6. Be part of the karaoke fun every Friday and Saturday night. Leroy's Tavern, a Westside tradition for 50 years at 2659 Mount Vernon Avenue.
Today's guest is brought to you by Reynolds Family Dentistry of Sellersburg. You need a million-dollar smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you'll get with Reynolds Family Dentistry.
Welcome back. Indiana Sports Beat coming to you here on this Tuesday from the Golf Club at Eagle Point Studios. And as promised, the great Mike DeCourcy joins us now. Mike, how are you, sir?
I am doing very well, Jim. How are you?
Doing fine, getting by on this second day of the week. I saw that nice piece you had out on all the football teams and their music. It was kind of cool because some of them I knew, some of them I absolutely didn't. Liverpool, you snuck that one in there. I was like, man, that one came out of nowhere. But that was some cool stuff. Just a cool, fun read.
You know, I don't know what got me thinking about that. A couple of weeks ago, it just sort of hit me as an idea that I could do. And it sort of felt like it was like an idea of the moment, because it's something that we miss through as we go through the pandemic. And I've been one, you know, I've talked on your show, Jim, a number of times about how the game matters most to me. And that's, you know, and those who have tried to say that sports aren't the same without the crowds that aren't, or I shouldn't say they aren't the same, because they aren't the same. But sports aren't good enough or worth our time or whatever I say, okay, like, did you see Kyler Murray throw the ball to DeAndre Hopkins on Sunday? I think that even with no crowd there, that was still pretty freaking amazing. And so the crowd isn't the most important thing, but it is a wonderful thing. Yeah. And going through the videos to find the right video for each of the 15 entries on the best stadium song traditions list was just, it was really moving to see the fans at Wisconsin jump around at the start of the fourth quarter to the song Jump Around, just to see 80,000 kids, well, not 80,000 kids, but 40,000 kids just all going crazy at the same time, or to see the entry of Virginia Tech's fans to Enter Sandman
that
by
is the
Metallica.
Best of all things. That,
that was
awesome.
Was my number one.
Oh, I know, and crazy. it's properly placed.
Yeah, it just to see the way the fans react, and you know, I'm not a metal guy. It's never been my kind of music, but that song is really the instrumental parts of that song are terrific. They just absolutely get you going. And so that was one that had to be on the list. And, you know, I'm a Steelers fan, and, you know, I've heard talk show hosts in Pittsburgh complain about the use of Renegade at home games and how it's played out and it's stale. And I'm like, you don't get it, man. A year ago, my anniversary present was to go to a Steelers Bengals game on a Monday night. And so it's Monday night and we're going to get up early on Tuesday and leave. And the Steelers are winning, I don't know, 26-8 or whatever it was. And my wife says, hey, you know, this is pretty much over. Can we go? And I said, here's the deal. We go as soon as they play Renegade. I'm not leaving before that. So those moments are just wonderful. And I can't wait. I really can't wait till we get them back. Indiana, when they play this song with the lady mopping up the hallway,
Martha the Mop Lady,
the Mop Lady, yes, you know, it didn't sort of qualify for the list because the list was mostly popular songs that had been adapted to use in stadiums. So I didn't do fight song type deals, but that's a magical moment. I love those moments. They're just they're just wonderful parts of our experience of going to games. And the list reminded me how much I can't wait to get back to that.
The woman whistling while you work, Mike. You know, I thought it was really bizarre when I first saw it last year, but I was kind of surprised. I just glanced at the list now that you didn't have South Carolina Sandstorm. That's kind of something that those fans there. But obviously,
I was going to ask you, Kevin, because among the criticisms that I got was leading off "I Won't Back Down" by Tom Petty. It's used at Florida games, and it's one I hadn't been aware of in doing the list. And when I went back and watched it, I thought, yeah, I could have had it, but It didn't hit me the same way that Renegade does, or that Welcome to the Jungle does at Cincinnati. So you tell me, did I screw up there?
No, well, no, it's a fairly new tradition. They only started about a year and a half ago. And I'll tell you a funny story. It's not really a tradition. I'll tell you another funny story. The first three times they played it at the Swamp, the Gators, this is under the end of the Jim McElwain era, they had fourth quarter leads, and they blew fourth quarter leads in all three games. After playing "I Won't Back Down," Texas A&M Christian Kirk returned a punt for a touchdown. And
that's great. Oh,
yeah.
All kinds of stuff going on, Mike, but nothing bigger. We were talking earlier that the entire NCAA tournament probably will be played in the Indianapolis area. Man, oh, man, that's got to be terrible for you right in the middle of your living room.
Yeah, I was going to say, how much of that tournament will be played in my house, literally? Yeah. As one of the things, as I was doing a lot of walks during the pandemic to get out of the house, I walked through my neighborhood about a zillion times, and my neighborhood screams Indiana when I do that, because probably one out of every two, maybe two out of every three homes has a hoop. And I love that. You know, there wasn't always a lot of kids out playing. There were a few sometimes, but every one of them had a hoop. And
a doorbell in Indiana, you got to have two things, a doorbell and a basketball goal in your driveway.
Yes. So I'm saying, you know, we can play at least part of the tournament here in my neighborhood if necessary. But I think it was something that the NCAA was wise to do, that they needed to do in order to assure that the 2021 NCAA tournament will occur, and they definitely have to have one. It's so important to the various athletic departments. It's important to the NCAA. They make about, like on a normal tournament, they make about $1 billion, give or take. And that this will not be a normal tournament. They will not make as much because they won't have capacity crowds in 14 different venues. They probably will have limited crowds, if any, in the venues that they use. And so they won't make $1 billion this year, but the TV alone is pretty close to 800 million. And so that, you know, there will have additional costs in terms of the tournament for this year because of testing and things like that, but they'll at least be able to make what they need to make in order to operate the NCAA. You know, I have friends who work there who had been on furlough during the course of this these last few months period. Yeah, I think 2 to 3 week furloughs that they had to take because the loss of the 2020 tournament hit the NCAA pretty hard. A lot of the smaller Division I programs rely on the money that they get from the NCAA tournament and got none for 2020. So it's been a hard year in college athletics, and getting a 2021 NCAA tournament will help a lot.
Absolutely. And then have it around here. We saw one of the Twitter characters, Martha the Mop Lady, sent out a pretty cool tweet that Rick Bozich retweeted with the using the Indiana high school gyms, the mini, that there are 11 gyms with 7,000 seats or more in Indiana, two of which have 8,000 or more. So its capacity is not a problem. But one thing that would be a problem that me and Kevin were talking about was the difference in size of the floors, which if everybody's playing, I don't know the difference, then it's a big deal. But 84, 94 in length, but I don't know that it makes that big of a difference, but man, what a cool thing it would see to see those venues being used.
Yeah. I don't, you know, don't forget that everybody's ready to do that. But if everything goes well, the high schools are going to need them. You know, they got a hoop too, right? They got the semi-states and all that stuff, the sectionals. So I don't know that that's necessarily where that's going to go, but I think there may be courts that exist in the state that are very prestigious, such as Assembly Hall or Mackey Arena, that they may borrow Hinkle. Hinkle for sure Hinkle, because it's in town, and Butler has already offered, you know, full cooperation. So I don't think there's any question they'll wind up doing some at Hinkle, but I think they'll put some people on buses, and this is just my educated guessing here. I think that they will use some of the other college gyms in the area. I think it'll be hard. Fort Wayne may be a little far, Jim. I think if you keep it to if you use Indiana State, Ball State, IU, Purdue, the State Fair Coliseum, Butler, if you use any portion of those, you're basically within a 75-minute drive or so. Fort Wayne pushes you up a little bit, so I'm not sure whether they'll go in that direction. But this is a fabulous state for basketball, and that's the most important thing in terms of being able to put together the tournament and stage it here. The fact that we have here in Indianapolis, we have a multi-court complex here in Fishers, at least one, maybe two. There's one up in Westfield called Grand Park that I think has like 100 courts. I don't know exactly the number. It's ridiculous. The place is an absolute palace. And I think those arenas, those venues – will be very handy for the NCAA in terms of finding practice facilities for the various teams, because they need all that in order to keep the teams functional during for four of them will be a 3-week stay.
Yeah, Jim and I went to that field house in Noblesville too over the summer too. They've got one there as well.
Right, exactly. There's so many different complexes like that. And, you know, there are a few of those around the country, but here in Indiana, you know, that we build them, you know, we have almost as many of those. We have cornfields.
Yeah, absolutely. And I can't think of a better place for it to be here. But how cool, man, that's going to be so fun if that comes to fruition for us to be here. I mean, I'm glad I'm not a reporter out in the middle of South Dakota someplace, but it'll be a lot more fun for us. And I think that's the only way this thing happens. I don't know that. But of course, we don't know the future. Like you mentioned earlier, we don't know what's going to happen with the vaccine and all that, but we can't plan for that. So this seems to be the absolute best course. Now we got to go back to football. Big game coming up this week, Mike, and I can't believe a top 10 matchup with Indiana, Ohio State. Indiana, though, listed as a 3-score underdog as a top 10 team.
Yeah, I think that's high. I think Indiana's better than that, although – Ohio State's terrific and will probably, if they get the opportunity, want to make as emphatic a statement as possible, especially since that Maryland game. And the one I talked in the preseason to Wyatt Davis and Sean Wade, and particularly Wyatt. Wyatt's an offensive guard for the Buckeyes, terrific player, a first-round draft projection. And he was very emphatic about wanting to play every game. And so they were going to do everything they could to make sure that they didn't have virus issues there. Whatever that was in their control, they were going to do it. And, of course, ultimately they miss a game because of virus issues in Maryland's program. And so they may be motivated to make a statement that says, okay, so we're not going to be 9-0, but we're going to be 8-0 with a significant victory over a top 10 Indiana team. They may be motivated to do that. But motivation isn't everything. Indiana has shown they are a fine football team. They really know how to play. They can make plays that you don't expect them to make. That the throw that Michael Penix had to Freifogel on the sideline, that Freifogel caught with his fingertips and stayed in bounds and ran down the right sideline. I mean, that was a big time play, both from the throw to the catch. To being able to stay in bounds and turn it into a touchdown. That was an amazing play. And that's not regular. That's not routine. That's not, we can beat the bad teams, but not the good teams. That was a big time play. So I think they're going to be a factor on Saturday. I think it's going to be a very competitive game. Although I would expect Ohio State to come out with a victory. I think it's going to. They're going to have to play great to leave with a win, and they're not going to be able to make mistakes like Michael made one on Saturday with that goal line interception. Obviously, Indiana is not going to be able to afford any of that sort of thing. They're going to have to play very close to their best. But I think that Ohio State is going to have to play really well to leave with any kind of victory, let alone a 3-touchdown win.
Kevin and Mike, both, I'll ask you this. What would you think would happen? Let's say Indiana plays them close, plays them tight, loses a tight game, then goes and wins out, beats a Wisconsin team, beats a crossover team that's probably going to be Northwestern maybe, to finish out with one loss to that team. Indiana, any shot for Indiana, a second Big Ten team getting into college football playoffs?
You know, I think that's a great question. It's one of the areas where I really don't care for the way the playoff works. I don't like anything about it. And one of the real problems I would have there is if you've watched the way Florida has been treated by the AP poll or Texas A&M, the one-loss SEC teams get this, sheen of glory that doesn't apply to anybody else. And I just don't think it's reasonable. Clemson gets something of a pass depending on what happens in their ACC title game. They'll get something of a pass because even though their quarterback played great against Notre Dame, they didn't have Trevor Lawrence, and he is a legitimately great college football player. So if they went out and lost a second time to Notre Dame, I think that would be the end. But if they went out and beat them and they split, that might change some things. But if you look at the way the polls have operated, with Florida in particular, I don't necessarily think it's really been I don't think it's been the same as a one-loss Big Ten team would be treated. And so, I think your scenario is really compelling. But I'm sure that Indiana fans, Jim, would first want to say, what happens if we beat Ohio State and keep winning? I think that's the scenario they want to know about.
Kevin, yeah, you covered Florida, Kevin. You spent a lot of time down there.
Yeah, you know, I don't know. You know, to me, it's I agree with Mike in a sense that, you know, with the Gators situation right now, you know, having that one loss against Texas A&M should count a little more because of the fact that, you know, it's obviously a competitive conference, but they're, you know, that Kyle Trask is playing a high level right now, but they're still you know, a team that, you know, I think has a lot to prove. And I just don't see him getting past Alabama either.
Well, it's going to, I can't wait. It's going to be compelling. I can't wait to this game because like Mike said, Indiana is a lot better than people think. Their skill players are better. It's like Peyton Ramsey. I love him as a quarterback, such a great veteran, solid kid, but they couldn't do this with him. There's a difference in that arm strength, the speed, and that's the difference to me, but between these two, and he's a big time player. He's going to play on Sundays. The arm speed he has and the accuracy, it's not, like you said, it's not normal.
Yeah. I thought that throw was ridiculous. And you know, I have liked him and liked his dynamism, the ability to make the play against Penn State. It took a big time athlete and one with not only just great speed but also great confidence to be able to, you know, to make that, you know, to make that decision to believe I'm getting to that goal line. That's a atypical college football play, and so I think there's a lot there, and I think the real challenge for Indiana on Saturday in terms of being competitive in the game will be defensively. Ohio State brings a lot. Their quarterback play has been unbelievable. It's been just staggeringly good. And obviously they have, you know, three or four or five or six, depending on how many they roll into a game on a given Saturday, wide receivers that are just great. I think Indiana has to put some pressure. We've seen on occasion Ohio State's line break down. They sometimes will make some technical errors in their offensive line play that allow defenders to get in and create pressure. And so Indiana's going to have some success at pressuring the quarterback if they're going to be successful on Saturday. I do think Indiana will score some points. Whether they can score enough to win if you can't slow down Ohio State becomes a real problem. And that's where I think putting pressure up front becomes paramount.
Looking forward to it, man. It's going to be a great game, noon on Fox. I think we got Gus Johnson with that. It's just a great week. You got the Fox pregame show coming in. It's a big deal.
Yeah, absolutely. Urban Meyer, big noon. Urban was saying some really nice things about IU's offensive line play on the BTN pregame show, the tailgate show on last Saturday. Had some really kind words to say about the offensive line. I thought that, you know, he does such a great job of breaking things down and was really complimentary of how good technically IU's offensive line was in the Michigan game.
Absolutely. Well, I cannot wait, but I also can't thank you enough as always, man. We love having you on and look forward to it again next week.
Absolutely pleasure, Jim and Kev, and can't wait to talk to you guys next week.
The great Mike DeCourcy from Sporting News, Fox, and the BTN. Look forward to having him on again a week from now. We'll be back with Chronic Hoosier after this. You're listening to Indiana Sports Beat coming to you from the Golf Club at Eagle Point Studios. Back right after this.
Hello, everybody. Jim Coyle from Indiana Sports Beat. When I'm not covering the Hoosiers, you can find me at Bubba's 33 in Clarksville, located on the northeast corner of I-65 at Veterans Parkway. Bubba's 33 has hand-tossed pizzas, bold burgers, and ice-cold beer from a select list of local craft brewers. An incredible food selection, all made fresh daily. Whether you're meeting the team for that post-win meal in the family dining area or meeting friends for happy hour to watch the game on one of Bubba's 50 TVs, Bubba's 33 in Clarksville. Pizza, burgers, beer.
We all want a winning smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you will get at Reynolds Family Dentistry in Sellersburg. Reynolds Family Dentistry has been serving the dental needs of Hoosier families for over 30 years. Let Drs. Roger and Jay Reynolds take care of your family. Just off of I-65 at 809 South Indiana Avenue in Sellersburg. Call 812-246-3368. That's Reynolds Family Dentistry, 812-246-3368.
Hey, this is Jim Coyle with Indiana Sports Beat Radio. We're now a part of the Rivals Network. TheHoosier.com is where you'll find complete coverage of the Indiana Hoosiers, as well as coverage of the Big Ten. Simply go to TheHoosier.com and sign up. It's free. You can also catch Indiana Sports Beat Radio there each day at your convenience, or you can find it any place you podcast or on this station each weekday. If we're not on the station where you live, we should be. Ask for Indiana Sports Beat Radio. Now that warm weather has arrived, it's time to hit the links, and there's no better place than the golf club at Eagle Point in Bloomington. Voted best golf course by the readers of the Bloomington Herald Times, the golf club at Eagle Point is under new ownership, has new fairways and bunkers, and it's open to the public. When the round's over, there's cold beer and a full menu at the Eagle Point Pub and Bistro. Call 812-824-1100 to make a tee time. That's 812-824-1100. The golf club at Eagle Point in Bloomington.
No matter where you are in life, here's a question to consider. Do you have the right financial advisor to help you navigate where you want to go? An Ameriprise advisor will take the time to truly understand what's important to you and help you prepare for whatever life brings, both the expected and the unexpected, by providing personalized advice based on your goals and needs and regular reviews along with digital tools to help you stay on track. With an Ameriprise advisor, you can feel more confident, connected, and in control of your financial life. Call Dennis Schneider, Heath Schneider, or Nick Davis with Schneider & Associates, a private wealth advisory practice of Ameriprise Financial Services. Call 877-827-1404. That's 877-827-1404. See Dennis Schneider at 236 North Elm Street in Henderson and Heath Schneider or Nick Davis at 20 East Campground Road in Evansville. Ameriprise Financial Services, LLC. Member FINRA and SIPC.
Does your bank offer the personal service of a community bank combined with big bank products that you expect? I'm Dane Chandler, Banking Center Manager with Banterra, and with our bank, you get the best of both worlds. Our easy-to-use mobile app includes conveniences like mobile check deposit. We offer competitive CD and money market rates, smart mortgage options, and unmatched business products and services. Switching to Banterra is easy. Stop by our locations to learn more. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
The college and pro football seasons bring friends together, and Leroy's Tavern is a place to watch all the games every week with the NFL Sunday Ticket while enjoying $1 Busch Light drafts every Sunday, Monday, and Thursday. Leroy's Tavern also features a $6 daily lunch special from 10:30 a.m. to 1 p.m. Monday through Friday, featuring a sandwich, fries, or onion rings, or a 7-inch pizza and a non-alcoholic drink for just $6. Be part of the karaoke fun every Friday and Saturday night. Leroy's Tavern, a Westside tradition for 50 years at 2659 Mount Vernon Avenue.
Today's guest is brought to you by Reynolds Family Dentistry of Sellersburg. You need a million-dollar smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you'll get with Reynolds Family Dentistry.
That I had reserved to.
Coming back here. Let's hold on. Welcome back. Indiana Sports Beat here, coming to you from the Golf Club Eagle Point Studios on this Tuesday. And you know what that means? Chronic Hoosier's with us now. Chronic, how are you doing, sir?
I'm doing well, man. Doing well. I never imagined just how good 4-0 would feel. But here we are. The sky's a little bluer. The sun's a little warmer. It's a good day in B-Town, man.
Yeah, it's going to be a rock'em sock'em robots kind of a deal on Saturday, man. We were just talking about that. Kevin Brockway here as well. Mike, of course, he was just with us. We were talking about that game at Indiana, a 3-touchdown favorite. I cannot believe that. And that's, you know, 3 years ago. Yeah, I buy that. But I cannot believe that they stuck Indiana with a 3-touchdown underdog in this game, which Ohio State's great. There's no doubt. They're really, really good. But I don't think they're giving this defense as much credit as they deserve.
You know, I wondered how much of that was perhaps skewed a little bit by the offensive ineptitude particularly in the second half last weekend at East Lansing. But I kind of feel the same way. I felt like that was a little disrespectful to this defense, the way they're playing right now. Obviously, some injuries remain unresolved as far as who they're likely to line up. But, you know, one thing we've seen so far is even if they've had a couple guys go down, they've still been competing at an awful high level. And, you know, quite frankly, I expect a better performance next weekend from Michael Penix and the offense than what we saw late. But, you know, what we saw was a team that absolutely dominated the ball pretty much on both sides, got sloppy, put it in cruise control, and still was able to shut out a Big Ten opponent on the road. So I would like to believe it's going to be closer than 21 points this weekend. Hell, I was talking to Zach. I don't know that it's dropped yet. We cut a pod Sunday night. He asked me how often these teams played 100 times does Indiana win? And I said a third, maybe closer to a quarter. I think this is a team that's capable of beating Ohio State, though. I don't think they do it more often than not. But I think this is a team that is capable of beating Ohio State. And I don't think that's always been the case in years past. We've certainly seen lesser teams compete late only to watch Ohio State stretch it out on us. These ain't your granddaddy's Hoosiers anymore. And hopefully they prove me wrong, or they prove Vegas wrong, rather. But I think it's going to be a lot more competitive than what the line would indicate.
Yeah, absolutely. I do as well. Last year, I thought they were going to be a little more competitive, but this is not even close to the same team from last year. So you got to wipe that out of your mind. I guess the big thing is, will this defense be able to slow down that juggernaut of Ohio State's offense from what we've seen? And it's going to be a true test. But Indiana has got a secondary that has been lauded all year with Reese Taylor and Tywan Mullen doing an unbelievable job. They're two of the best in the country. So it's going to be a great football game. And I can't believe that with a top 10 matchup, you have a 3-touchdown spread, but I don't care about that anymore. But it's the attention Indiana's going to get, the attention that they've been getting. It's just been a nonstop commercial for Indiana football.
Well, I think the thing that people are missing is Ohio State, you know, they're down 8 starters on defense. I mean, they do have Sean Wade. But this is a defense that's been vulnerable. I mean, they gave up 27 to Rutgers. You know, they gave up some points to Nebraska and Penn State. They gave up 25 to Penn State. So this is not the same dominant Ohio State defense as last year. So I would expect a lot of points to be scored. I mean, if you're a betting person, I mean, what I would jump on is the over. You know, the fact that I think that this is going to be a game where you're going to see a lot of points scored. I do agree. I think Indiana is going to fix some offensive issues that they had from last week. And you know, listen, Michigan State under Mel Tucker, a defensive coach, it did come up with some things in the red zone probably that, you know, were effective as well at home and tried to play hard and tried to keep from being completely embarrassed in that game. But I think that there are going to be a lot more points scored in this game than people think. And I think the big question will be, can Indiana's defense, which has improved, but can they really slow down a quarterback in an offense as dynamic as Ohio State?
Right.
You know, I think not only is the defense going to have a stellar day in order to give Indiana a chance, quite frankly, I think they're going to have to continue that takeaway streak, and they're going to have to find a way either by doing it themselves or putting the offense in position where they can turn some turnovers into points. I think that's going to be absolutely critical. You know, we've said in weeks past the importance of playing smart and playing clean on the offensive side of the ball. I think that's going to be paramount as well for this team. Minimizing penalties, they're certainly going to have to win the turnover battle if they want to have a chance. But more importantly, as we've seen, you know, when the defense is able to get the ball back for the offense and put them in a position on the field where they can convert that to some points, I think that's absolutely how Indiana's going to have to play if they're going to have a shot. You know, one thing, though, that we asked several times leading up to the season as we've kind of pondered throughout, that I really like heading into this weekend, however, Indiana's ability to bring their own energy and to make it happen, especially at key moments in the game. They've been extremely opportunistic in the way in which they've been able to, as Coach has said, bring their own juice. And in a completely empty horseshoe, I think that's got to tilt towards Indiana's favor, playing on the road against a team just as capable as Ohio State is. You know, this is what they came to Indiana to play for. You know, they find themselves now with the ninth rank in the AP poll, chance to take on a top five team in Ohio State on the road. Just what a tremendous opportunity. And, you know, win or lose, I fully expect this to be one of the better games of the season in the Big Ten. As we've looked across the board, this has the implications of basically, you know, winner of this one has a whole shot at the Big Ten East Championship and a chance for the college football playoffs. So the fact that we're talking about Indiana in this conversation is certainly no small feat for what this team's been able to accomplish. But quite frankly, I don't think they're done yet. I think they've got a lot more to prove. And this is, you know, in a season where they've just shredded the history books, what a better way to put a cherry on top than to finally excise the demons of the Buckeyes.
Absolutely. I cannot wait. Looking forward to that game. Turning to basketball, a little recruiting information. Mustafa Imzel committed to Dayton yesterday, along with a couple of top 50s. They're doing really well, but that's one Indiana was trying to get. And then also now Mason Miller's decision coming tomorrow, expectedly tomorrow, possibly Monday. Archie Miller's trying to get a Zoom meeting with him, I think, to change that. But I don't see this one going Indiana's way, Kronik.
You know, they certainly have lost some momentum on the recruiting trail here as of late. You know, a lot of conversations taking place right now trying to figure out exactly what the plan is here next season and beyond, because, you know, you look at front court particularly, once you lose Joey Brunk, you know, the reasonable possibility that this may be Trace Jackson Davis's last year, that leaves you awful, awful thin inside down low. And it's not a very good position to be in here in the Big Ten, anywhere for that matter, but especially the way in which you see this league built and the way this league competes. So, you know, I'm going to remain cautiously optimistic that there is a plan. You know, it's certainly going to be a wild year with eligibility now basically being paused. You know, a lot of guys are going to become grad transfer eligible, probably going to have to see some significant movement on that front in order to really round this roster out, though, as a lot of the high school recruits are popping away from Indiana right now.
Absolutely, and I hope that changes, man. But this weekend is a big weekend. You got the numbers going up, so people got to try to keep people safe and yet still try to enjoy. We got the high school football that's kind of coming down to a close. You got the high school basketball that's about to start. So we got a lot of Thanksgiving coming up, all kinds of stuff going on right now, Kronik.
Yeah, it's certainly a wild time. I mean, there are so many things up in the air right now. We've got the confluence of all these, you know, having the Masters in the middle of November is still wild to me. But it's a hodgepodge of activity right now. And like you said, man, we got to stay safe. Everybody's got to stay safe.
Well, I appreciate you, brother, every week, and look forward to following up on this game this weekend.
Looking forward to it. Catch you guys next week.
Thank you, brother. Kronik Hoosier joining us here on Indiana Sports Beat, Kevin. I know we talked about it earlier, but buddy, Archie's in a little bit of a bind, and I know that fans don't like to hear that, but I've been talking all year about them being thin at this wing spot, and it's getting no better. And you go into a fifth season, and you're still trying to put together your first full roster? That is not good.
The way it looks next year would be, you know, if Race Thompson obviously comes back and Logan Duncombe, I mean, you would have them up front. But you're right. I mean, it's, you know, certainly a little thin.
That's not elite, though. That's not elite, and that's not playing at elite level. That's not playing to win a Big Ten championship and certainly not playing to win a national championship. So what are we doing here?
Yeah, I know. You're going to have to find another guy, and maybe you do it through the grad transfer route. But, you know, Jim, it's funny, you know. I mean, sports is a funny thing sometimes. Sometimes you can have all-world guys and it doesn't come together. Sometimes you can have a guy that comes out of nowhere, like an Obi Toppin. You don't know. I've covered enough college basketball over the years. Joakim Noah, Al Horford, they were top 50, top 100 recruits, but they were McDonald's All-Americans. Corey Brewer was a McDonald's All-American, but was known a little bit more for his defense, was more in that Trace Jackson Davis range of McDonald's All-American. So sometimes
developing talent goes a long way.
Yeah,
that's another developing talent. You've got another issue though. When talent does not develop at a consistent level, you add that to the pile of issues, and I'm not seeing that.
Yeah,
I don't know that anybody's seeing it.
That's what you have to do. If you're not recruiting at a high level, you have to be a developmental program, and that's kind of where Indiana is going to have to be if they don't land these names. They're going to have to develop what they have and maybe change their style and maybe be, you know, last year they were a more conventional team, but where did that get them? You know, just barely, you know, possibly making the NCAA tournament.
How many changes have we already seen? We're in our fourth season, and yet a second change already. Last year was going to be an up-tempo offense, did not materialize. This year is supposed to be that now. It's, wow. I'm like, there is no – Not only is there no consistency, there's no matching to the words.
Yeah, well, no, but I mean, this year could be – last year's team was not as up-tempo as people would think in terms of, the fact that, you know, you didn't really have that many guards on the floor. The biggest issue is skill level, and the biggest issue is you can be up-tempo all you want, but you got to take care of the basketball also, and that's the biggest issue, and that's where, you know – maybe when you lose a guy like Devontae Green, maybe that's addition by subtraction because, you know, you don't have the guy throwing the ball all over the gym. Now, Devontae also was probably responsible for two of their biggest wins last year from a scoring standpoint against Iowa. And so it's kind of a 50-50 thing where you lose some of that. But the consistency and throwing the ball all over the place and being disciplined and being able to score in the half court, which you have to do in the Big Ten, I think that's really the biggest issue, you know, the skill level, taking care of the ball, shooting got a little better last year, but still needs to pick up. You still need those shooters as well.
Hey, we got a lot more coming up here on Indiana Sports Beat. Listen to you. We're coming to you from the Golf Club at Eagle Point Studios. We're back with more right after this.
Hello, everybody. Jim Coyle from Indiana Sports Beat. When I'm not covering the Hoosiers, you can find me at Bubba's 33 in Clarksville, located on the northeast corner of I-65 at Veterans Parkway. Bubba's 33 has hand-tossed pizzas, bold burgers, and ice-cold beer from a select list of local craft brewers. An incredible food selection, all made fresh daily. Whether you're meeting the team for that post-win meal in the family dining area or meeting friends for happy hour to watch the game on one of Bubba's 50 TVs, Bubba's 33 in Clarksville. Pizza, burgers, beer.
We all want a winning smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you will get at Reynolds Family Dentistry in Sellersburg. Reynolds Family Dentistry has been serving the dental needs of Hoosier families for over 30 years. Let Drs. Roger and Jay Reynolds take care of your family. Just off of I-65 at 809 South Indiana Avenue in Sellersburg. Call 812-246-3368. That's Reynolds Family Dentistry, 812-246-3368.
Hey, this is Jim Coyle with Indiana Sports Beat Radio. We're now a part of the Rivals Network. TheHoosier.com is where you'll find complete coverage of the Indiana Hoosiers, as well as coverage of the Big Ten. Simply go to TheHoosier.com and sign up. It's free. You can also catch Indiana Sports Beat Radio there each day at your convenience, or you can find it any place you podcast or on this station each weekday. If we're not on the station where you live, we should be. Ask for Indiana Sports Beat Radio. Now that warm weather has arrived, it's time to hit the links, and there's no better place than the Golf Club at Eagle Point in Bloomington. Voted best golf course by the readers of the Bloomington Herald Times, the Golf Club at Eagle Point is under new ownership, has new fairways and bunkers, and it's open to the public. When the round's over, there's cold beer and a full menu at the Eagle Point Pub and Bistro. Call 812-824-1100 to make a tee time. That's 812-824-1100. The Golf Club at Eagle Point in Bloomington.
No matter where you are in life, here's a question to consider. Do you have the right financial advisor to help you navigate where you want to go? An Ameriprise advisor will take the time to truly understand what's important to you and help you prepare for whatever life brings, both the expected and the unexpected, by providing personalized advice based on your goals and needs and regular reviews along with digital tools to help you stay on track. With an Ameriprise advisor, you can feel more confident, connected, and in control of your financial life. Call Dennis Schneider, Heath Schneider, or Nick Davis with Schneider & Associates, a private wealth advisory practice of Ameriprise Financial Services. Call 877-827-1404. That's 877-827-1404. See Dennis Schneider at 236 North Elm Street in Henderson and Heath Schneider or Nick Davis at 20 East Campground Road in Evansville. Ameriprise Financial Services, LLC. Member FINRA and SIPC.
Does your bank offer the personal service of a community bank combined with big bank products that you expect? I'm Dane Chandler, Banking Center Manager with Banterra, and with our bank, you get the best of both worlds. Our easy-to-use mobile app includes conveniences like mobile check deposit. We offer competitive CD and money market rates, smart mortgage options, and unmatched business products and services. Switching to Banterra is easy. Stop by our locations to learn more. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
The college and pro football seasons bring friends together, and Leroy's Tavern is a place to watch all the games every week with the NFL Sunday Ticket while enjoying $1 Busch Light drafts every Sunday, Monday, and Thursday. Leroy's Tavern also features a $6 daily lunch special from 10:30 a.m. to 1 p.m. Monday through Friday, featuring a sandwich, fries, or onion rings, or a 7-inch pizza and a non-alcoholic drink for just $6. Be part of the karaoke fun every Friday and Saturday night. Leroy's Tavern, a Westside tradition for 50 years at 2659 Mount Vernon Avenue.
Today's guest is brought to you by Reynolds Family Dentistry of Sellersburg. You need a million-dollar smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you'll get with Reynolds Family Dentistry.
Welcome back to Indiana Sports Beat, coming to you from the Golf Club Eagle Point Studios on this Tuesday. Kevin Brockway is sitting in with us now. Kevin, we talked a lot about Big Ten football, Big Ten basketball, Indiana specifically. They are a 3-touchdown underdog, as we've mentioned, to Ohio State this weekend. And I'm just not seeing that. You pointed out that they're without 3 starters on defense, which, yeah, and I know it's Ohio State and they plug guys in, but I don't care. This is not a mid-level Big Ten team. Indiana is an elite team right now, and they have elite playmakers. I think they're going to make life difficult on Ohio State. And if they can get the offense to where we thought it was going to be, a lot better than what we saw last week, they can make life difficult for Ohio State, especially you take a turnover or two, Kevin, and that makes that game a completely different outcome.
You know, I think it's going to be interesting to see is that Ty Freifogel has obviously been very good all season long. Where's been Wop Fillier? And Wop Fillier last year kind of benefited from Nick Westbrook and Donovan Hale getting extra attention. And does it flip back? And does Wop have a big game? Or does, you know, do you put extra attention on Ty Freifogel and does Wop? And is Ty benefiting from all this coverage on Wop Fillier? I'm curious to see that whole dynamic. And, you know, does Michael Penix spread the ball? I think actually in the last game, particularly in the red zone, they didn't get Peyton Hendershot involved enough. And Peyton was really good, if you remember, in the red zone in the Rutgers game where he scored those 2 touchdowns. They had that really good quick tight end screen that they used on the goal line. You know, maybe Michigan State took that away, but he's another guy too. They're going to have to use all their weapons, but offensively. But they can I firmly believe there's no Chase Young. There's no dominant defensive guy on that side of the ball for Ohio State. I do believe that they're going to be able to score some points at Ohio State Stadium. And it's going to be, you know, really a question of, you know, how much they can contain Fields, how much they can, you know, deal with Chris Olave and that offense that's on Ohio State's side of the ball that's fairly dynamic as well.
Well, what Indiana has not done this year, they have not put much pressure on opposing quarterbacks. They've gotten to them some in some games, but and if you don't get to Justin Fields in this game, boy, that's going to make life difficult out there for those DBs. But it's the same in reverse. I think Indiana can make life a little more difficult on Ohio State's DBs because they have more weapons, as you just mentioned. Wop Fillier, who's been taken away a little bit because he's drawn more focus, but it's kind of pick your poison. If you want to focus on Wop, look out for Ty Freifogel. And if you want to focus on him, they've got 4 or 5 more options. And as long as – and I asked Nick Sheridan about that, do you worry about Michael falling in love with – you know, they had such a great run with Ty Freifogel last week that a quarterback can kind of fall in love with the receiver sometimes and just start looking for him. And that is not good, but I think they'll be fine. But, yeah, I think Indiana has more weapons. And if Michael Penix can accurately hit them this week, I think this is going to be a heck of a lot better game than people think.
Yeah, Penix has only been sacked once his last three games. He's getting the ball out quickly. And I think the issue with, you know, the pass rush, which they listen, they did get four sacks against Michigan State. But Lombardi was a fairly stationary target until they brought in, the backup quarterback, Peyton Thorne. So they were able to get to Lombardi fairly easily because he wasn't a mobile guy. With Justin Fields, you can get to him and he can elude you, you know, and keep his eyes downfield. And or if you're not, you know, good in the rush lanes, he can scramble, he can dart and make a 20-yard play out of a pressure. So it's that's going to be the tough test too when you're facing a dual threat quarterback like that, you know, finding ways. But Jovan Swan, no sacks so far. Maybe he was supposed to be brought in to be a guy that got to the quarterback. That has not materialized. They haven't really gotten much off the edge other than, you know, James Head, who's played pretty well. But with the blitzes, they've been effective. And Micah McFadden, two sacks. I've seen some saying two sacks. I've seen some saying, yeah, three sacks. But I guess one was credited as a tackle for loss on a kind of a scramble. But they've been effective with their linebackers and defensive backs getting the quarterback.
Absolutely. I talked to Coach Allen. That's one of the things about this. Using this three-touchdown underdog thing as a chip. And we'll play that clip with Tom Allen to see how he talked about using this as a motivational tool.
Well, like you mentioned, I mean, you shouldn't need motivation to play the Ohio State Buckeyes. And so it's really like we've always talked, you know, it's about us, you know, and that to me is just, is not a, you know, it's nothing other than just, you know, people's opinions about where they think their program is compared to our program and where they think their team is compared to our team and how they think the game is going to be, you know, decided on game day. So, I mean, it really means nothing, but at the same time, it's the perceptual reality of where people see the program and where they see this game going. So, you know, it is what it is. And, you know, we'll discuss things. We'll talk about them. We'll use them to our advantage when it's appropriate. But this football team is highly motivated. This team has worked extremely hard. And we're used to being told that we don't measure up.
There's Tom Allen and talking about being a top 10 team and listed as a 3-touchdown underdog. Well, he's handled this quite well, I think. All this new exposure, he's done a media tour nonstop. He's been a media darling. Everybody loves him, and rightfully so. But he seems to have really handled this very well. The team, because that's a concern. I mean, it's all that new excitement for them. They've handled it well. He's done a masterful job, and that staff, of keeping those guys level-headed and keeping them in this new money. It's like, you know, winning the lottery and you got all this money and you're not used to it. He's done a great job. They've done a good job with these kids, I think.
Yeah, and I think that, too, it's, you know, with Tom, it's going to benefit in recruiting, I think, for years to come, this kind of a season, and being out there and showing kids that they can come to Indiana and be successful. I think that's where you, that's where you really benefit from a season like this. And you have to cash in on a season like this as you try to get is. And it's kind of a shame they have a smaller class, right? But, you know, you try to make the most of this class and then the following class in terms of, you know, showing people, hey, you can come to Indiana, you can be part of a big time football program, you can win, have success, have this family atmosphere that we've got here. There's a lot of positives to it. And Tom is taking advantage of it and also showing his personality. And I think he's showing that he's a fun coach to play for, right? Like he's, you know, I think I've said this before, he's a young 50, you know what I mean? He's very in tune with the players, in tune with the kids. Seems to care about them, and seems
they know that's the most important thing. He doesn't seem to care about them. They know he cares about them. Yeah. They, and that's the thing. Everyone knows he is completely legitimate, sincere. There is nothing. A perfect example, and I don't mean this to cut on PJ Fleck, but the row the boat thing. Yeah, that's nice and kitschy, but that's all it is. It's kitschy. Row the boat. It's not a lifestyle. It's not Tom Allen. This is a lifestyle for him, and it's not just the words. It's what's behind the words. And he literally means it. And it's hard for us because we see that a lot, but most of those people are not legit. They're not sincere. They don't really live it nonstop. Tom Allen does nonstop. He is what he is. You get what you see. And those kids know that. It comes through. And more importantly, it comes through with their parents when he's recruiting them. Because I got news for you. There's a whole bunch of parents sitting at home right now, Kevin, saying, that's where you're going to play.
And I think the best thing last year around this time that certainly Indiana did, that Fred Glass did, was give them that extension, because Arkansas was, you know, some SEC programs are knocking on the door. Arkansas was knocking on the door. And, you know, Tom's, he's a guy from Newcastle. You know, he has dabbled, obviously, you know, in the Southeast in terms of, you know, being an assistant coach down there. But I think this is where he wants to be, and this is the program he wants to build. And they rewarded him in kind financially. And that is turning out to be a fairly good investment. You know, the fact that he's going to be, and you know, I have friends in the SEC, you know, the South Carolina job just came open with regards to, you know, Will Muschamp being let go. And someone mentioned, oh, well, Tom Allen's name was mentioned in the podcast for South Carolina. He's not leaving Indiana for South Carolina. I think this is where he wants to be. He's a Newcastle guy. And they showed that they backed up. They showed, now if they didn't give him the extension, yeah, maybe he would go to the SEC. But I think they showed that financial commitment to him and his staff, and the commitment to resources. And listen, there's more to build. I you know, I wrote about this last year, and I think what they did around the stadium was nice, but still, maybe, you know, that indoor practice facility down the road 4 or 5 years ago could be another wow piece for recruits as well. You know, just building on the facilities as well. Like, it's not perfect, and it's still not as good as what you've got in some other Big Ten programs, you know, around the region. So, you know, there's still more investment to do, but I think they're on the right track. And it began with obviously extending Tom and, you know, taking care of the coach.
Well, we'll get that other clip ready. I'll tell you exactly what these players see and what the reason that these guys are going to play for him and do play for him and will continue to play for him. This is Tom Allen. You talk about straight up sincerity. This is him, man. Go ahead, Will.
I believe to be Will God. So, I just love to just pour my heart into those kids. And that's what we did. And so it's been a long journey, but it's been awesome. And my kids have sacrificed and my wife. So that's why it hurts so much for Thomas, because I know what he's been through to get here. So he's a tough sucker. So I'm blessed. It's made me who I am. I love this place. I love these kids. We're going to fight, man. I don't care what anybody says about this stinking game. We're going to compete, and we're going to fight. And good Lord willing, we're going to find a way. Keep proving everybody wrong. That's all I got to say.
But that's a lot. That's Tom Allen talking about just the constant battle that they've been going through, and as a program of Indiana's stature or lack thereof. And I think that it's going to get old quick, like this 21-point underdog thing. It's a slap in the face. They see it as a slap in the face, and as they should. And that's going to get old quick if they don't start feeling respected, if they continue to play that well. It's going to be interesting to see how Indiana turns around from being a nice team to start being a little mean team, start putting some points on people.
Yeah. And I think too, you know, that wearing emotions on her sleeve, you know, it brings to mind Dick Vermeil, right? Back in the day, you know what I mean? And he is a guy who was, wore his emotions on his sleeve and was very successful, and the players loved him and they played hard for him because of that. And there's that old school thought, right, that, you know, doing that is a quote-unquote sign of weakness. But I really think it's a strength, you know, the fact that, you know, you can show your players that you care, that you're passionate, and that, you know, certain things can move you to that level of emotion that it, you know, means so much. And particularly the issues beyond football, the injury of son, and, you know, just how much he cares, not just for him, but for all the players on the team, their well-being, which, you know, should be first and foremost for every coach, every program. You don't always see it that way. But it doesn't always happen that way. But I think the best football programs create that culture where they're invested in their players and their players' lives and their players' future. And I think Tom has done a good job with that.
Absolutely. Hey, we got to take a quick break before we get out of here. We're listening to Indiana Sports Speak coming to you from hole number 6 here at the Golf Club at Eagle Point Studios. And we're back with more right after this.
Hello, everybody. Jim Coyle from Indiana Sports Beat. When I'm not covering the Hoosiers, you can find me at Bubba's 33 in Clarksville, located on the northeast corner of I-65 at Veterans Parkway. Bubba's 33 has hand-tossed pizzas, bold burgers, and ice-cold beer from a select list of local craft brewers. An incredible food selection, all made fresh daily. Whether you're meeting the team for that post-win meal in the family dining area or meeting friends for happy hour to watch the game on one of Bubba's 50 TVs, Bubba's 33 in Clarksville. Pizza, burgers, beer.
We all want a winning smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you will get at Reynolds Family Dentistry in Sellersburg. Reynolds Family Dentistry has been serving the dental needs of Hoosier families for over 30 years. Let Drs. Roger and Jay Reynolds take care of your family. Just off of I-65 at 809 South Indiana Avenue in Sellersburg. Call 812-246-3368. That's Reynolds Family Dentistry, 812-246-3368.
Hey, this is Jim Coyle with Indiana Sports Beat Radio. We're now a part of the Rivals Network. TheHoosier.com is where you'll find complete coverage of the Indiana Hoosiers, as well as coverage of the Big Ten. Simply go to TheHoosier.com and sign up. It's free. You can also catch Indiana Sports Beat Radio there each day at your convenience, or you can find it any place you podcast or on this station each weekday. If we're not on the station where you live, we should be. Ask for Indiana Sports Beat Radio.
Now that warm weather has arrived, it's time to hit the links, and there's no better place than the Golf Club at Eagle Point in Bloomington. Voted best golf course by the readers of the Bloomington Herald Times, the Golf Club at Eagle Point is under new ownership, has new fairways and bunkers, and it's open to the public. When the round's over, there's cold beer and a full menu at the Eagle Point Pub and Bistro. Call 812-824-1100 to make a tee time. That's 812-824-1100. The Golf Club at Eagle Point in Bloomington.
No matter where you are in life, here's a question to consider. Do you have the right financial advisor to help you navigate where you want to go? An Ameriprise advisor will take the time to truly understand what's important to you and help you prepare for whatever life brings, both the expected and the unexpected, by providing personalized advice based on your goals and needs and regular reviews along with digital tools to help you stay on track. With an Ameriprise advisor, you can feel more confident, connected, and in control of your financial life. Call Dennis Schneider, Heath Schneider, or Nick Davis with Schneider & Associates, a private wealth advisory practice of Ameriprise Financial Services. Call 877-827-1404. That's 877-827-1404. See Dennis Schneider at 236 North Elm Street in Henderson and Heath Schneider or Nick Davis at 20 East Campground Road in Evansville. Ameriprise Financial Services, LLC. Member FINRA and SIPC.
Does your bank offer the personal service of a community bank combined with big bank products that you expect? I'm Dane Chandler, Banking Center Manager with Banterra, and with our bank, you get the best of both worlds. Our easy-to-use mobile app includes conveniences like mobile check deposit. We offer competitive CD and money market rates, smart mortgage options, and unmatched business products and services. Switching to Banterra is easy. Stop by our locations to learn more. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
The college and pro football seasons bring friends together, and Leroy's Tavern is a place to watch all the games every week with the NFL Sunday Ticket while enjoying $1 Busch Light drafts every Sunday, Monday, and Thursday. Leroy's Tavern also features a $6 daily lunch special from 10:30 a.m. to 1 p.m. Monday through Friday, featuring a sandwich, fries, or onion rings, or a 7-inch pizza and a non-alcoholic drink for just $6. Be part of the karaoke fun every Friday and Saturday night. Leroy's Tavern, a Westside tradition for 50 years at 2659 Mount Vernon Avenue.
This segment is brought to you by Bubba's 33 in Clarksville. Pizza, burgers, beer.
So lady, let me take a look at you now.
All right, welcome back. A little blast from the past there. Who sings that? Who is that? I know Kevin, though. Who is that, Kevin? There you go, Little River Band. Man, blast from the past there. I love it. Welcome back, Indiana Sports Beat, coming to you here on this Tuesday. Kevin Brockway sitting in. Been a great show. Man, full. Lots going on. Man, what was I going to talk about this weekend? Oh, what did I just say in the break we wanted to bring up?
Indiana has forced 12 turnovers. They've lost four. They lead the Big Ten in both takeaways and turnover margin. Of the 12 takeaways, Indiana has scored.
That's what has to happen. And it can happen. Indiana has a chance in this game. So you're saying there's a chance.
Well, Fields is really good with making decisions. He doesn't turn it over very often as far as interceptions.
That's a big thing. You know?
And Lombardi was benched for a reason. He was throwing interceptions before that Indiana game, and he threw two more, and that's why they put him on the bench. And, you know, Noah Vedral and Joe Milton, they're guys that have been throwing picks as well. Joe Milton really didn't throw his till the fourth quarter. And Clifford, too, is another guy that's had issues throwing interceptions. So I think it's going to be a little bit of a different animal in terms of a quarterback that will probably be a little better in his decision-making. But there are still ways to force him. You know, I think, too, about Ohio State, they haven't run the ball particularly well. They don't have a J.K. Dobbins on this team either. They don't have a dynamic running back. And, you know, maybe you force turnovers that way, too. We saw Thomas Allen before he got hurt, which was a shame because he made a great play on a strip of a running back of Williams in the first half of that game against Michigan State. So most of Indiana's 12 turnovers have been forced, Jim. They haven't been by happenstance. And it's something that Tom Allen coaches and it's something that Tom Allen preaches. And if you remember last year, they had issues early in the season getting takeaways. It didn't really come until later in the season. But this year, right off the bat, they're creating them and they're forcing them.
Absolutely, and that's important because you can get fluky lucky and it not mean a whole lot. But when you are forcing the issue, that's what you can rely on. And it's also something that puts you in the mind of the opposition, that they have to counter on that they know that you're a ball hawker. Ironically, now they're going up against Kevin Wilson. He's had two weeks to watch this defense. So that is an advantage that is going to be tough to overcome, though. That's difficult.
And speaking of Ohio State's bye week, I don't know if you saw the video clip, but they had a little fun on Friday night in their
dodgeball or something.
Little dodgeball in their practice facility. I was wondering where Patches O'Halloran was. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You need the coach there from dodgeball or Ben Stiller, White Goodman. That would be good. Vince Vaughn. You know, get them involved. You know, if you can dodge a wrench, you can dodge a ball.
Exactly, and they're going to need to dodge a few wrenches on Saturday. But hey. So they're without three defensive starters. Are those guys out, hurt?
No. They are
lost.
They are only returning three defensive starters. They're down eight defensive starters from last year, including Chase Young. And they've had a lot of issues defensively, Jim, throughout this season. They have not been sharp on that side of the ball. I mean, they've been giving up points. Now, in the case of the Rutgers game, I mean, there were some fluke plays. There was that throwback. They picked up where they left off from the Indiana game where they did some fluky things and they scored in the second half when they were down 35-3. But I still think they're a little vulnerable on that side of the ball and they have been, and they've been giving up points. But if you read most of the national previews of Ohio State, that was somewhat to be expected given the losses on the defensive side of the ball. They just don't have the same talent on that side of the ball that they had last year.
The toughest stretch that they were test they were going to face defensively would probably have been this week against Maryland and Tagovailoa, who has really come on, and it would have given them some preparation for Indiana and throwing the ball. So maybe it's a good thing they didn't play Maryland. I don't know, because they didn't get that preparation of playing against a different quarterback that is successfully throwing the ball around right now, and Maryland is. But we'll see. It would have been a tough test.
You know, and I wrote about that in my Big Ten column today, the rush factor. It certainly didn't show for Wisconsin. I mean, they went up to Michigan and just boat raced them and crashed them. But Michigan is just a train wreck right now under Harbaugh. There are a lot of issues there. Even with effort, if you watch that game on Saturday night, it looked like tackling was optional in that game in terms of some of the effort that was brought forth. But Purdue, on the flip side, you know, they weren't connecting with their receivers as well when they had a week off against Northwestern. And Jeff Brohm alluded to maybe that being a little bit of a factor. So We'll see how Ohio State responds. I would think that Ohio State would probably respond a little more like Wisconsin than Purdue did, just by the fact that I think Ohio State's a fairly talented team, but maybe there will be a little rest with Fields with connecting with his receivers.
Well, Indiana can hope for that. I don't expect there to be any rust this deep into the season now, and especially since he looked pretty daggone good in week one. That's the one thing about this team is offensively, they did not look rusty from the get-go. They've looked pretty smooth in that regard. But we'll see how it goes. Looking forward to it. Man, it's been a fun day, and I cannot wait. But it's going to be a big-time deal. And like I said, I'm looking forward to, even if they lose the game, I think they're going to play him better than what the three-touchdown deal. And then I think the big game after that is going to be Wisconsin. Man, they've got to go to Wisconsin. There is no tougher schedule in this country than Indiana is playing in football. They go to Ohio State. They go to Wisconsin. They played Michigan State, Penn State, Michigan. It's probably a Northwestern team on the horizon. Wow. You talk about as tough a schedule as you can get.
And I'm going to be there on Saturday. I'm looking forward to going to the Horseshoe. I've never covered a game in the Horseshoe, you know. So that's going to be a lot of fun, and that's going to be an experience. Of course, no fans, but it's still going to be interesting there to be in that kind of historic stadium and to see if Indiana can possibly pull off the upset here.
Absolutely. Well, we'll be looking forward to it, man. We'll look forward to talking about it next week. And I hope you have a safe trip over there, but looking forward to it. Thanks a lot for everybody for joining us. Cannot thank Kevin enough. Thanks a lot to Mike DeCourcy and, of course, to Chronic Hoosier. Tomorrow, make sure you join us. It's Dustin DePerrick should be with us, but Jordan Hulls will be sitting in as well. So looking forward to that. So another big day tomorrow. But go out and have yourself a great day. Do something nice for somebody. Please wear your mask. And until tomorrow, I'm Jim Coyle. I will see you on the radio.